welcome to sing it with me this morning if you like.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see
one more time.
Church,
are you happy to be in the house of the Lord on this day where I'm thankful for air conditioning? So thankful. I'm not a summer person, even though I like flip-flops, but that's another story. Why don't you go shake someone's hand this morning? This song, you may know it. We sang it Wednesday if you were here, but this song is called Hosanna in the Highest. Go say hi to somebody, okay?
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord our God, Hosanna in the highest.
We're going to say Jesus is the Prince of Peace.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord our God, Hosanna in the highest.
Now glory to the King of Kings.
Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord our God, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord.
some of y'all knew that song this morning. If you have found your way back to your seat, find a hymn book in front of you. If you found your way to someone else's seat, still find a hymn book in front of you. That's okay, too. There's room enough. Find song number 3. I know I say this a lot, but this is one of my favorite hymns. And this song is called Jesus Paid It All. If you know it, sing it with me. If you don't, you can still sing it with me. That's okay.
I hear the Savior say, my strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Verse 2.
More now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Verse 4.
And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all. To him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Thank you for singing with me, church. You may be seated.
Thank you, Miss Candy. Good morning, church. So good to see everyone here this morning. Welcome to our visitors today. And glad you're here today. And it's a good day in being God's house. Amen. Amen. More than one reason we have air conditioning. Amen. Even though it doesn't seem really icebox cold, that's okay. It's still cold. God bless each of you for being here today. Ask you to lift in prayer. Cindy and John Catlin, her mother had passed away. God bless you. And her mother, Velma McKean Hogan. At her service the other day, it was a wonderful service. I'm just glad to get to meet her. God bless her. And also, we're celebrating some anniversaries. I get rid of my reading here. Shirley and Nicky Blanton celebrate their anniversary on the 14th here. Give me my hand this morning. Amen. And Leela and Oliver McDowell celebrate their anniversary on the 26th. There she is. Amen. Amen. That's the ones I know about right now. And in the building, we've got several birthdays, and we'll lift them up and praise God for them as well. Like I said, it's good to see everyone here this beautiful Sunday morning. On the back, you've seen some beautiful yellow T-shirts back. We're looking to have a trip to Noah's Ark. They're in Williams, Kentucky. I got that right? Williams, Kentucky. And we'll let you know more about that. So keep tuned into that. And so we're looking forward to that. They're just awesome shirts. I love it. And looking forward to that event as well. Keep Mary and Jeff Smith in your prayers. They're traveling this week as well as others. I ask you to bless those also because the heat is out there and it's really tough. So I ask you to keep those in prayers having to work in this. Amen. And this morning we went for a lot of wonderful treats this morning. A real blessing. Looking forward to that. We'll go ahead this morning taking up our morning tithes and offerings. If our deacons would come forward, please. That would be great.
Very day and very hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, how's everybody doing this morning? Oh, come on. We look like we're filming the final season of The Walking Dead this morning. You know? Hey, dang. We can do better than that now. All right. You know, okay. At least perk up a little bit. I can just cut the air off. Y'all want me to do that? Okay. All right. Well, anyway, we got a real treat for you this morning. Our musical guest is coming to sing for us. He found us on our radio station, and that's just wonderful when someone discovers our church through listening to the radio station, and now he and his precious wife are part of our family here. Let's welcome Kelley Foust as he comes to sing for us.
Am I using this mic or this one? This one. Well, Dave, thank you for such a warm and loving welcome. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today?
Amen.
That's right. Jesus is our all in all. Amen. Amen. This song, it means a lot to me. It's ministered to me in times of my life when I've been hurting. And a lot of pain in my heart, broken heart. And continually crying out to God and asking God to help me and to deliver me. And there's a lot of people, I think, in the house of God today, church members in the body of Christ. We need that same deliverance. I hope that this song will help somebody and touch somebody, that the Lord would use this to minister to myself and to other people who really need to be touched by these words. This was a psalm of David. He said, I prayed to the Lord, and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. Those who look to him for help will be radiant with joy. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. In my desperation, I prayed, and the Lord listened. He saved me from all my troubles. For the angel of the Lord is a guard. He surrounds and defends all who fear him. Blessed is the man who walks in your favor, who loves all your words and hides them like treasure. In the darkest place of his desperate heart, they are a light. A strong, sure light. Sometimes I call out your name, but I cannot find you. I look for your face, but you are not there. By my sorrows, Lord, lift me to you. Lift me up to your side, Lord of eternity, Father of mercy, look on my fainting soul, keeper of all the stars. Friend of the poorest heart, touch me and make me whole. my defender? Who is against me? No one can trouble or harm me if you are my strength. All I ask, all I desire, is to live in your house all my days. Lord of eternity, God of all mercy, come to my troubled soul. Keeper of all the stars, friend of the poorest heart, touch me and make me whole. Lord of eternity, God of all mercy, come to my troubled soul. Keeper of all the stars, friend of the poorest heart, touch me and make me whole. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you. Dear brother, amen. Give him another hand. That's beautiful, wasn't it? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for that. Well, at this time, we're doing our summer round robin. We're still hanging in there with that. It's wonderful. Hear what God has laid on these person's hearts. We have a blessed one to come bring us a quick message today. I asked Reverend Nicky Blanton to come for you. I'll put his hands for him. All right. Thank you, sir, everybody.
Let me say this starting off. I covet your prayers. I seem to be out of step. I didn't know we were going to have the Lord's table today. So let's ask Jesus' help. Lord, if I'm out of step with this message, blessed Savior, please correct me. Help me to share your gospel truths from your word. Truthfully and sincerely, help us receive the message you'd have us to receive. Help us to be genuine to your faith in this very hour. Help us to get it right. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I guess if you could title this message, it would be, "You're either in or you're out." If you have your Bibles, and it ought to be like your heart or an appendage that you have, it ought to go with you everywhere. You should never let anything separate you from the Word of God, especially within your being. Amen. Will you turn with me to Isaiah, the 14th chapter, and I'll start with the 12th verse. Isaiah 14 and the 12th verse. Before I say that, let me say this. You can look around. I don't care which direction you look. And pride will not be hushed anymore. Pride takes the high seat. Pride demands your attention. Demands your loyalty to it. Pride demands you serve pride. I'm going to start with the 12th verse of Isaiah. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did awaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also in the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Can you see that in this world today? I say, can you see that in this world today? Everywhere you turn, listen. Satan knows he has a short time. He can't hide himself any longer. His pride won't let him. Watch now. Watch for him. Everywhere you turn. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. That's God's word. Amen. Turn with me to Matthew, the 6th chapter. The 6th chapter of Matthew. And we're going to be looking at several scriptures, and I want you to know something. You fall in love with the Word of God. Amen. It's the keeping power of the Christian. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word what? Was God. Amen. Cherish God's scriptures. Matthew 6, I'm going to read the 22nd and the 23rd verse. Here we go. All right, this is what 6, 22 and 23 say. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of light, shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that light? There's a lot of things going on in the churches that are just foul balls. Absolutely wrong. They know it. Paul asked the question when he walked this earth, is Christ divided? And my answer is certainly not. God's word will make it plain. You seek his face and find it out. Amen? Christ is not divided. There's not liberal Christians and there's not conservative Christians. It don't work like that. There is the holiness of the only begotten Son of Almighty God who hung on the cross to cleanse us from our sins and to keep us from our sins, to deliver us from the power of darkness and from the evil one. Turn with me to the 4th chapter of 2 Corinthians, please. I'm going to read just a few verses here. I tell you what. If you've got any questions about anything, you can find them in the Word of God. Most amazing thing, it's just unbelievable how God's laid it all out for us. It's incredible. It's hard to comprehend sometimes, but you look and there it is. It's amazing. The words of light in life. Hallelujah. I'm going to read the first four verses. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not. But we have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. By manifestation of the truth. That is Jesus revealing himself to us. Amen? But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not. Lest, listen to the power of the word of God. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. You know what happens then, right? Conversion. An heir to glory when they receive Jesus. Amen? Turn with me to Isaiah, the 24th chapter. I'm going to read one verse. Isaiah 24. Isaiah 24 and verse 5. The earth is also defiled under the inhabitants thereof, because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, broken the everlasting covenant. Go back with me to Genesis, the 19th chapter. No, wait a minute. Let's do this. Go with me to Genesis, the 3rd chapter. Genesis, the 3rd chapter. I'm going to read just a couple verses here. Now the serpent was more subtile than any of the beasts of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said? Think about that a minute. Just think about that just a minute. Yea, hath God said, you should not eat of every tree of the garden. Did he say that because he knew what God had said? Of course he did. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Turn with me to Obadiah. It's in between. It's right after Amos, I think. I couldn't swear to it. I'll have to look and see. Obadiah. I think it's right after Amos. I'm going to read one verse here. And yeah, it's right after Amos, and it's right before Jonah. Yes, thank you, Pam. Listen carefully now. Verse 3. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, that thou dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? You shall not surely die. That's what Satan said, didn't he? In all his pride, Lucifer, song of the morning. What does morning imply? The morning implies light. If the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? Are you getting this? Listen, the deceiver is very clever. He comes to us even as angels of light sometime. That's how he worked his way in the church. A place he don't belong. Right? He can infect. I call it lethal injection. The rotten thoughts that come. You know, how do you determine? We determine from God's word. But when thoughts are against Christ, you always know that that comes from hell. You always know that that's an antichrist spirit knocking at your door. You know? Christ said when he was here, it was already in the world. When Jesus was sharing some of his messages, what happened to some of the church people of the day or synagogue? They stirred up the crowd, started a riot, didn't want to hear his word. Let's see. You know, folks in America have got a lot provided for them. Well, living large, cleft of the rock, big house, two cars, pretty sweet. No time for God. No time for the Lord Jesus Christ. Be careful that your mind has stayed on the Lord. Satan is very clever. He's very clever, not to be taken lightly. Let me show you just how clever he is. Turn with me to Revelation 12. We know the book of Revelation has a lot of symbols and spiritual meaning, but this one's easy to see. 12, and I'm going to be reading the fourth verse. Let me read the third verse to set the stage. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having seven heads and ten horns and seven crowns upon his head. Do this for me. Jump right down to verse 9 before we continue. Verse 9, I want to make this clear for you. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which devoureth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. All right, now we're going to read verse 4. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, that would be Israel, which was ready to be delivered for to devour her child, that would be Jesus, as soon as it was born, the spirit of Antichrist. But this is what I want you to see. How many stars was dragged out of heaven with the tail of Satan? One-third of the angels in heaven. You are dealing with a formidable enemy, people. I'm going to tell you something, and I'm not here to praise Satan. I'm here to make you aware we are not ignorant of his devices. You must keep that in mind. Because when you know the enemy is attacking you, you go right before the Lord. Straight to God's word, straight to prayer, and guess what? When you acknowledge the name of Jesus Christ from your heart, what's going to happen? Satan's going to flee. What's going to happen to your vision? Going to clear up. You're going to be able to see it clearly. I promise you that. Just a couple more verses. Let's see here. Turn with me to Malachi, the second chapter. Malachi, the second chapter. It's toward the end of the Old Testament. Guess what? It's the last book of the Old Testament. My bad. My bad. All right. The second chapter, and I'm going to read the, I think it's the 17th verse. Let's read the 6th. Oh. Let's read the 17th verse. Ye have wearied the Lord with your words, yet ye say, wherein have we wearied him? When ye say, everyone that doeth evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delighteth in them, or where is the God of judgment? There's a whole lot of church people getting this thing wrong. I'm not saying in solid rock. We have a fine pastor who preaches the word of God, and the spirit of the Lord is here. But there are things going on in churches that are absolutely against the word of God. And I didn't hear to come in here today to church bash. But I'm going to tell you something. There's right and wrong, and you can't call evil good, and you can't put evil for good and good for evil. It don't work. It's opposite. They oppose one another. Yeah. That's 5:20 in Isaiah. Look it up sometime. The scripture says, woe unto them that call
evil good, and the good evil. Put bitter for sweet, sweet for bitter. Some of you know the scripture I'm talking about. Look it up. Listen, this is a serious thing. The one that breathed into us sent his son to save us. So he gave us life, and then he gave us eternal life. And we're wholly meant to share the gospel truths. Ideally, Nicky Blanton would get out of the way and speak only the word of God. We're being made like silver and gold people. The dross is being swept away, all the impurities, and we're being made more Christ-like. That is our goal, amen? When you get that crown of glory to offer up to Jesus, oh my gosh, can you believe that? Can you believe that you'd have the opportunity to do that? Or me? It's coming. If you're blood bought, it's coming. Oh my gosh. You glorify Him here. Guess what? You're going to glorify Him there. Woo! Oh, Lord, have mercy. Come on. Huh? Praise God. Let me turn one last scripture. 1 John, toward the end of your Bible. 1 John, the third chapter. 1 John, third chapter. Can I say this before we look at this scripture? 1 John, the third chapter. I'm going to read the 8th verse. When I go down to immigration and I get to share, when I used to be with, when I go to immigration, I get to go less and less now, but I still go minister to those men who are locked up. I say this, and I mean it now as much as I ever have. I mean it every time I say it before them. It's more than a pleasure to share the precious words of God with you. It's something I feel unfit to do. It's light and life for me. I hope you understand that. It's light and life for you. That's what the Word of God is. That bread from heaven. Amen? Third chapter, 8th verse. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that He might destroy the works of the devil. Praise You, Lord of Lord and King of kings, Jesus Christ. My Deliverer, my Savior, my Redeemer. Glory to the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Nicky. Amen. Amen. I like that. This time I have our children's church dismissed. I just saw the lady in the back. And Brother Mike does come bring us our scripture reading this morning. We appreciate our children's church. God bless each of you. Amen.
Good morning, church. What a day to be alive. I just want to thank God this morning. I'm going to thank God this morning that we're here today. Yeah. That we're here right here in His house to hear His word today. I know I rant and rave up here a lot about what's going on in this world, and there's plenty to rant and rave about, no doubt about it. But we're in God's house today, and I'm gonna say God's in control right here. In fact, He's in control of everything. Even as wild as this world is getting right now, God has His hand on it. So fear not, as the Lord would say. I also wanted to say one more thing, because I was touched. I know people have lost people that's dear to your heart. So have I. We all have lost people along the way. And it's going to happen. The older we get, it's just part of life. It's the way it goes. I have an aunt right now that's clinging on to life. She's 82 years old, and she's one of the prompt people of our family. She's the last person of her immediate family, which is my father's direct family. So I know what it's like. I lost my dad in 2000. I almost lost my son in 2000. So I've been through it too, folks. But the great hope of all of this is we're going to see them again. Yeah. This is not the end. This is the beginning, folks. This little life that we call life here on this earth, it's like the Lord says, it's gone in a puff of smoke. It goes so fast. I used to always think about that when I was 20 and I was going, man, it's not a puff of smoke. It's going pretty good. And I'm 62 years old and I'm telling you, it goes like a puff of smoke. Poof, and it's gone. So don't think you got time to get right with the Lord. Because none of us are guaranteed another second in this world. And the way this world is going right now, it might be shorter than that. But God is in control. He holds the key to everything. He's the maker of heaven and earth. We think we have big problems down here. Sometimes I get down too. You know, the pressures of this world right here just get to you sometime. And then I think, man, he hung the stars and the moon. He keeps everything in order. If it weren't for God, this world would be gone a long time ago. So I hang on to that precious hope right there. We're going to see our loved ones again. We are going to see them again. And we're not going to see them like we saw them before. They're going to be in those new heavenly bodies that we're all going to get that God has promised us. And oh, what a day. I praise God every day. I try to every day. I know I harp and moan on a lot of stuff that goes on in this world. And God forgive me. But I just feel like I need to warn people of what's coming because a lot of people don't understand the book. They don't understand what's going on in this world, much less what's going on biblically at all. And it's a lot of people in family. It's a lot of friends. A lot of people in that situation. And I'm not claiming that I am an angel sent from heaven because I'm far, far from that. But I am someone who has been woken up. Because I tell you, folks, you take 15, 20 years ago, and my name was right up there amongst the top of the page, I can assure you. Not because I was such a bad person, but it's because I didn't have God in my life. God wasn't in my life. I was more worried about me, us. I was more worried about the family. Hey, let's get ahead. I was in business for 10 years, and I'm telling you, it's a dog-eat-dog out there. I ran a trucking company for 10 years. And the way businesses are going right now, it almost pushes you into being that evil person just to compete. But we're not in that anymore. We're not in that competition anymore. That left us a long time ago. Bye-bye. Lord gave us all of that. Man, we could do anything we wanted to. We were rolling at one time. We were pushing $4 million in business at one time. And I'm telling you, He took that away from us just like that because he knew that's what we needed. We were getting up into this world. Hey, man, like Nicky said, two cars, a fine home. I'm looking for stuff to buy. I want to have some fun. And I think of all that money and all that time that I could have put right here and tried to help build this house. I was building my own house. I wasn't building God's house. So God said it was time for that to go. I'm going to show you what the real world is all about, Mike. Let me show you what it really looks like down here. Boom, it's gone. And I'm telling you, folks, when you get that rug drugged from underneath you like that, it's a wake-up call. Because we went from having everything to we couldn't rub two nickels together. It was tough. We lived in that dollar menu at a McDonald's for over a year. Thank God for McDonald's. Amen. Thank God for McDonald's. But the world is changing and changing fast, and it's going to continue to change fast because that's what God said was going to happen. This is just starting here now, and we're going to start rolling. So I'm going to tell everybody to hold on to that cross. Everybody needs to take a hold of that cross this morning and ride this out. Because without God, you're not going to ride far. You're going to perish. God says you're going to perish. It's like Nicky said, you're either in or you're out. There's no gray area in this right here. There's no gray areas. So if everyone rise this morning, I'm going to read in true Donald Trump fashion 2 Corinthians this morning. You know, I say that and I do laugh about that, but God, I hope he keeps him protected. Because, you know, I hate to get political, but I'm going to. It's either we're going to go down the Republican path or we're going down the Democratic path. And everybody can see the path that we're on. I'm not real sure. I don't think anyone can save this nation but God himself. But I do think that we can get our nation back in a more godly path. And God help us, Donald Trump is going to do that. God moves in mysterious ways, folks. That's all I can tell you. His ways are not our ways. But God bless him. I hope he protects him. And I hope we can get our country leading back down a road again of godliness. At least some morals and some character. Forgive me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'll be reading through the 10th verse. I'm reading from the book. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, when we die and leave these bodies, we will have a home in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long for the day when we will put on heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we will not be spirits without bodies, but we will put on new heavenly bodies. Our dying bodies make us groan and sigh, but it's not that we want to die and have no bodies at all. We want to slip into our new bodies so that these dying bodies will be swallowed up by everlasting life. God himself has prepared us for this, and as a guarantee, he has given us his Holy Spirit. So we are always confident, even though we know that as long as we live in these bodies, we are not at home with the Lord. That is why we live by believing and not by seeing. Yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. So our aim is to please him always, whether we are here in this body or away from this body. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged. We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done in our bodies. God praise his word. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Mike. Appreciate Brother Kelley and Brother Nicky and Brother Mike for blessing us and pointing us to scripture this morning. Amen. I should give them a hand this morning for blessing us being here today and pointing us to the scripture and God's word and laid on your heart to bless us. Now for Dr. Cash.
In a few minutes, we're going to be looking in John chapter 14. But I got a little something special I want to do for all of you today that has lost a loved one lately. And I mean in the last few years. I can relate to that, and probably the most recent is Cindy back there buried her mom Thursday. And whenever we go to a funeral, we always have it told on our perspective. Well, I got a little recitation that I swiped from Carmen this morning that I'm going to give it from the person who has passed on from their perspective. And I'm going to have part of my choir up here to help me. And you may go ahead and get it started, Candy, if you would. I was still aware of those around me. I could hear their cries and sense their grief, but was physically incapable of responding to them in any way.
There was surprisingly no sensation of death, but without doubt, I knew I was dying as my spirit and body naturally and without effort began to separate. An entirely new dimension of reality unfolded like the slow opening of a rare flower. Celestial mysteries were revealed from beyond. The atmosphere was permeated with the healing melody of an invisible choir, and I knew I had entered the domain of the living God. My eyes beheld a vast concourse of souls from every nation, dressed in the spotless garments of the redeemed, and with a loud voice they echoed praises to their King. I saw a mighty throne around which was seated 24 elders with crowns of glory, and like the sound of rushing waters, they began to sing,
"Holy, holy, 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 holy is the Lord."
One more time.
"Holy, holy, 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 holy is the Lord."
The whole principle of living was different. Food and water wasn't needed to sustain life. There was no mental agony, no tears, a source of tears, or any physical pain. Light did not come from one source like the sun, but God's glory illuminated everything. Shadows did not exist, neither did elemental changes like snow, storms, or even rain. Then in all of its pristine grandeur, I saw the holy city suspended like a cube at the expanse of eternity, 1,500 miles high and just as deep as it was wide. Indescribable colors were refracting everywhere from the precious stones it was made of. With 12 angels guarding the gates fashioned from one solid pearl on each side. Then from behind me I could sense the presence of one whose virtue shot through the very fibers of my being. And as I slowly turned, a glorious radiance consumed my eyes. His silhouette was backdropped by an immense sea of glass. And for the very first time, my eyes beheld one altogether lovely, the lily of the valley, the fairest of 10,000s, my Lord, my Savior, Jesus Christ. I threw up my hands and cried, "Holy, holy, holy." Sing it with me, y'all.
"Holy, holy, 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 holy is the Lord."
Everybody.
"Holy, holy, 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 holy is the Lord."
Thank you. His eyes were filled with tenderness, encouragement, strength, and love. His countenance proclaimed he knew everything there was to know or ever worth knowing. Being with him was to have everything I ever wanted, to be everything I ever imagined and arrive at everywhere I only dreamed of going. And then the same voice that spoke the worlds into existence spoke my name in affectionate tones, and he said to me, "There will be no more tears nor sorrow nor crying, for behold, I make all things new." All right, let's look now to John chapter 14. Jesus said this, and this is why that you should have hope this morning, you should have joy this morning, there should be no sadness about what's coming in the future and all of that. Jesus said this, he told his disciples this, and he's telling you this right now. "Let not your heart be troubled." No, Sean Hannity did not invent that phrase. Jesus did. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. There are three things, and I'll be very brief with you this morning, that I want you to understand about heaven. I know you've watched stuff on the cartoons before, and you see some dude up there sprouting wings and playing a harp. I'm sorry, you're not going to see that in heaven with us. You will not become an angel. You were not one down here, and you're not going to be one up there. You'll be saved, but you will not be an angel. I cannot picture somebody as fat as I am with a pair of wings on. They'd have to have a huge pair to keep me hovering. Huh? Well, that's right. I won't be fat up there. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that encouraging word. And I don't particularly, and I don't particularly want to listen to a harp all day. If it was a mandolin or a banjo, that might be all right, but I'm sorry. You're not going to become an angel. But there's three things I want you to know about heaven. One is the joy of regeneration, and I'll get to where Pam was at right here. You'll have a brand new body. There will be no disease. There will be no pain. You can't die anymore. Everything will be absolutely perfect. I was telling John back here this morning, I had probably one of the worst low sugar episodes I've ever had in my entire life, about the last 10 years since I had diabetes. I remember praying right before I ever came down with that, and I said, "Oh Lord, please make me sweet," and he overdid it. And I felt so bad this morning, thank God for Hostess Cupcakes. Whew, that saved my life. Yes, sir. So the next time I'm gonna fake a spell so I can get a couple more of them Hostess Cupcakes. But you won't have that no more. Won't be no problem. I wonder if they'll have Hostess Cupcakes in heaven. I sure hope so. I know they're going to have country ham. But you're going to have, it's going to be regeneration. You're going to have a brand new body. Take a look at that ugly thing in the mirror right now when you get home, and then you say, I'm going to have a brand new one. All of my teeth, and a whole lot of this weight gone, and I'll get my muscles back and all of that, and there won't be no gray running through my head, and some of y'all ain't got nothing running through your head. You'll get your hair back. It'll be wonderful to have all of that back again. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51. Paul said, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep or remain dead. We shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed." I'd like to be standing in Fort Hill Cemetery right when that went down. When the church is taken out, I'd like to watch those graves open and go right up, and then we go right up behind them. "For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that's written, 'Death is swallowed up in victory.' O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." The joy of regeneration. You'll get a brand new body. Most scholars think it'll remain at the age of 33. That'll really be nice, because that passed me about 27 years ago. It would be wonderful. Now, I know some of you young folks think 33 is old. Oh, no, you will long for the days of 33 sooner or later. You just hang on. The next thing that will be evident in heaven is the joy of reassociation. Everybody in here has got somebody that they look forward to seeing in heaven. All of the saints that died in Christ, those that were saved, everybody that was saved, you will see them again. You will see people from the Old Testament, the New Testament. You will see your grandparents, your aunts, your uncles, your brothers, your sisters, your moms, your dads, and even some of you will see your children in heaven. What a wonderful time. We've had so many people that have left us here from this church in just the last few years that have passed away. People that we have loved dearly, and we look around this morning and we see a lot of empty seats, and even though we got about six families on vacation this week, there's still a lot of empty seats where people that would come every Sunday, they're not with us anymore. They passed away. I remember the one closest to me is my mother. She passed away a year ago back in February, and I miss her every day. She was my mentor. She was my friend, and she could argue me any time of the day, and we would get into some of the best ones. And I miss her. She had lots and lots of wisdom. And she was just my best friend. I mean, we were very, very close. We talked every day. And you know what, though? If I could bring her back right now in the condition that she was in, I would never dream of doing that. No, no, no. I'm glad she is in the presence of the Lord right now, and I'll get to see her. She's up there with some crazy company right now. Y'all know some of the people that left here, what characters they were. And they're probably keeping the Lord pretty well occupied up there in heaven right now. But there's going to come a day when we get up there, there won't be no more goodbyes. There won't be no more sorrow of losing someone. That we'll all be together forever and ever and ever. The joy of reassociation. And then finally, the Savior's commendation. The Savior's commendation. Matthew 25:23. The Lord said unto him, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I'll make thee ruler over many. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." I mean this with all my heart. And I mean this. Anybody that knows me knows I mean this. If I go before any of y'all, I don't care if I have a dime to my name. I don't care if my kids wind up paying my bills. I've got that in the will, by the way. Y'all gonna have to take care of that. I'm not worried about a thing that I have possessed while here on this earth. The only thing I'm concerned with is, did I please the Lord? Did I do what He wanted me to do? A pat on the back down here is nice, but it don't have a bit of meaning when it comes to eternity. All I want to hear is the Lord look at me and go, "Well done, well done." And I want my children to be able to say that I left them the legacy of Jesus Christ. That's all I care about. That's what Patrick Henry said before he died. That's all that he was concerned with, leaving his children. And can't you imagine hearing the Lord Himself telling you, "Well done"? Well, folks, we have a lot to do down here before He does come to get us, or before we leave, whichever it is. And all of the things that we occupy our minds and hearts with all the time will amount to hardly a hill of beans in heaven unless it's done for the Lord. This is a serious, serious time in history right now where I believe the Lord's return is very, very soon. And only what is done for Him will make a difference. Well, you've heard a little bit about heaven, okay? How do I get there? Well, don't ever look at TV to find out how to get there, because they'll send you to hell is what they'll do. They'll tell you, "Oh, there's many paths to heaven." No, it didn't. Listen, let's hear it from the Lord's mouth. Jesus told His disciples, He said, "Whither I go, you know, and the way you know." There's always one in the crowd that says, "No, we don't know." And it was Thomas, doubting Thomas. Thomas said unto him, "Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus said this to him, and He's saying it to me, and He's saying it to you. And I want you to understand this morning that there is no religion on this earth that will get you to heaven. No religion. Only a relationship with Jesus Christ Himself. Not religion, not denomination, but a relationship. And Jesus said unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." So this morning, as we get ready to close out this service, if you want to see your loved ones again that are in heaven and you're not saved, you need to be saved or you will be eternally separated from them and the Lord. There is no second chance to get right with God after you die. There is no second chance. I read this week one of the most awful stories of a father and son that were doing some work on a house, and they accidentally slid a ladder onto a high voltage wire, and it killed both of them instantly. And you know, I'm not trying to be morbid or crude, but neither one of those two guys had any idea that this was going to happen when they got up that morning and went to work. So don't ever think you can plan your death or you can plan the time you're going to leave this earth, because it will come when God is ready for you to come. And it's important that you are the one that's ready to go when He calls for you. There is an appointed time for each and every one of us to leave here. I do not know when it is. I have no idea. And I'd rather not know. I really wouldn't. But we better be ready when He does call. And so having said that, I'm going to ask if everyone would just bow their heads for a moment. I want you to don't pay any attention to what anybody else is doing around you. I want you to focus on your own heart right now and on your own soul, because this is the most important thing. Are you or are you not right with God today? Has there been a time where you asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins and you began walking with Him? Or are you living in such a way that if He was to come back for you today, you would be embarrassed? Oh my, this is so, so crucial. Folks, I'm going to give you an opportunity to make these things right with Him today, because this is the most important thing that you will ever do in your life, and that is to decide to follow Jesus Christ. I'm not asking you to become a Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Pentecostal, anything. I'm asking you to become a Christian. That's the most important thing you could ever do in your life. And so having said that this morning, I just want you to think real hard. Am I really saved? Or am I just playing church? Or have I been fooled by the devil into thinking that I'm saved? Look at what you're doing in your life. Is it reflecting what the Word of God says? And if it's not, then something is very, very wrong. Well, folks, this morning is the opportunity to get it right. I'm going to ask if some of our ministers and prayer warriors would come down here and stand beside the altar. And what I'm going to do is, when we give the invitation, if you need someone to pray with you, these folks love you. They are the sweetest people in the world. And they'll take a Bible and they'll open it and show you some scriptures, or they'll pray with you, or whatever your need is. But do not leave this building not right with God. Please don't do that. We're going to go to the Lord's table in just a few minutes. And if you are saved, you are invited to come to this table. It doesn't matter what denomination you belong to, but if you know the Lord as your Savior, we're going to invite you to come and participate in the Lord's Supper. Maybe you need to come and pray and just get things ready before that. Whatever the situation is, I'm going to ask if everyone would stand. And if you have a need in the next few minutes, as Candy sings a song here, would you come? Maybe you just need to come and pray around the altar, or maybe you need somebody to pray with you. Either way, take these folks by the hand and tell them, I need somebody to pray with me. Would you come while we wait?
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day.
Have a need, would you come?
The one who saved me by His grace, when He takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, no more when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day.
With her if you know it.
Try me, oh Lord, and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.
Time and then we'll close.
Everlasting. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, O Lord, and know my thoughts. And see
seated, please. I'm going to ask if Nicky and Matt would come forward, please. Again, this is the Lord's table. This is not Solid Rock's table. This table is open to anyone who is saved and knows the Lord. Before we distribute the elements this morning, I'm going to ask if Brother Nicky would dedicate the elements to the Lord before we offer them this morning. Let's pray, folks.
Lord Jesus, we pray for your blessing upon this very special occasion, Lord Jesus, to show your sacrifice, that you came, blessed Savior, that you died for us, to make a way for us to come home with you, Holy Jesus. Bless everyone, Lord Jesus, help us all reflect upon what you did on Calvary's cross this day and every day, and may we pull up to your table, Lord Jesus, as you would have us to, fulfilled in you, living Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When Jesus distributed the bread, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And when he distributed the cup, he said, "This is the blood of my New Testament, of the New Testament, which is shed for many." And then he said, "I will not do this anymore until I do it anew with you in the kingdom." But until he returns, we are to celebrate what he did for us on Calvary and how he shed his blood and gave his body. And so having said that, I'm going to ask if this section would come first, all of you who feel led to come and participate, and then this middle section, and then the end section down here.
Thank you.
it was customary to sing a hymn before the disciples went out of the upper room. Since my minister of music over here is the one who knows all the hymns.
No, I'm not Leela.
Okay. Do you have one that we'd like to do here? And just want to remind you, Bible study is here at 7 o'clock on Wednesday night. Everybody's welcome. Come as you are. Thank you so much, all you visitors that are here. I tell everybody this. If you come one time, you're a visitor. If you come two times, you're family.
That's right.
You're automatically accepted, okay? Well, you're accepted the first time.
That's right.
So good to have you. We're going to sing a hymn, and then after that, you're dismissed.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.